they focus on a biting point. See this Ben right here. Kenny actually won the light contest on our Facebook. Going to turn that jig out.
Coming around, you step towards me.
Black and purple laser man.
He got some row for steelhead season.
Peeling light, peeling light.
Come around this side, Dave. I got a leader. Go back, go back, go back. She's nosing down. You okay? Here.
Here we go.
Come this way, come in this way. I can't let her turn and shake at all. You ready? You ready? Okay, she's reviving. Nope, running out that way. Move, 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 move.
Watch out, coming around. You step towards me, hug my back.
Hug my back here.
You're ready, Dave.
Coming around you. Coming around you. You're okay. Coming around you. Coming around.
Get her. Get her. Net. Head first. Go. Go. Woo! Hey, if you want to take us on some laps, but fishing the boat, brothers.
Boat.
Yeah. Whoo. Nice little hen to start it off. Maybe 13, 14 pounds. Not too big, but good start. Okay, I'm gonna put us back in line here.
Black and purple laser minnow all day. I heard Nick, the informant fisherman.
That was the second fish we've had on today. We lost a big in about 45 minutes ago, but we're out here jigging a tributary to the, watch that jig, to the Sacramento River. We're gonna go over some new techniques and methods with you and hopefully put you guys on some more fish. Let's go get some more. All right, guys, now with some advanced jigging techniques for salmon. Let's talk about the fish positioning on certain tides. You know, if you're up in a river where it's constantly going out, yeah, you can fish the pools and pockets. You know, it's pretty obvious. But when you're jigging a tidal system like a Sacramento tributary, the Sacramento River, the Mequalamy, wherever you go out there, you're gonna have tidal system. Now, where the fish position on that tide is absolutely critical to how you fish it. You always need to be going with the tide. It's gonna help control your drift, and we'll go over that. But on the outgoing tide versus the incoming tide, well, what's the key difference there? Most salmon travel at low light, early in the morning, early in the evening, at nighttime. You'll see them rolling on the surface. That's a clear indicator that these fish are traveling upstream. So that means you can go and cut them off. What it also means is more than likely they're not positioned on the bottom, not the majority of them are positioned down there. That means they're moving through quick. When that sun's out overhead and you have that outgoing tide, they want to rest. That's their time to rest. So they're gonna get in those deep inside bends on the river, and I'll show you on the fish finder how to find those. And they're gonna rest on the bottom. That's when we're taking our jig and we are actually hitting the bottom when we're jigging. That's when we're actually hitting it. On an incoming tide, and if it's still low light, a lot of the fish are not so much pinned down to the bottom. So you can hit the bottom, take a crank up and reel. What that's gonna help you with is not snagging, but you'll still be in the fish's face a lot of the time. So with that being said, on those slack tides, basically at those moments, you wanna try a variety of things in your boat. You wanna have a guy suspended jigging. You wanna have a guy bouncing the bottom. You wanna have a guy throwing a spinner just to find out if there is one fish that's gonna work one way, and you can figure out a system at that time. So incoming tide, you know those fish could be spread. They can be out on a current seam. A lot of the time I tell people, look where the debris is in the water and try fishing each side of the debris and right down the debris. You can find fish right there a lot of the time. They may not be active. One on the bottom, one suspended jig. You can go from there. The outgoing tide, those inside bends, those deeper pockets, bouncing off the bottom. If it's low light, you gotta remember those fish are traveling fast. If you hit them in one run and you come back through and you don't hit them again, move up a run and try from there. So hopefully those positions help you out. Now, when I talk about bends in the river and where the salmon should be positioning, you could see, like, right here, you have a long straightaway, so chances are you're not going to find any holes for that outgoing tide. But let's say you have an outgoing tide and it's flowing down this way. You can clearly see this bend right here. There's a little island on it. So that water is going to be forced to hit that bank and turn out. So you're going to have a washout. You're going to have a deeper section in there with a cleaner, harder bottom. So that outgoing tide, the salmon should be positioned in here. The same thing when it's incoming. It's probably going to be making a harder impact to this area of the river down here because it's incoming. It's getting swirled up. You're going to have back eddy circles. They're not going to dig as deep. So on an outgoing tide, I would probably target this area. On an incoming tide, I would drop down to where the river runs straight and then hits another bend in this area. So that'll help you get you a better percentage of fish that should be stacking up in those areas at those times. So if it's running out, hit the first area next to a straightaway with the bend. If it's an incoming tide, hit the first area, you know, to the south end of that river or wherever you see the current hitting the bank and turning. A lot of the time you'll see those back eddies circling around the bank. You look on the graph, you graph along, you don't see any trees. I'll jump over here on my Garmin and show you too, for example, the area that I'm sitting in right here. You can see a fish right there, a clean bottom line. It's 14 foot. If I shift over a couple feet to my left, it'll go 16, 17, 18. And I like that area that's around 15 to 23 feet off the bank that has that little trench, you know, that little ditch in there, and then comes up to a sandbar. So I know the salmon have to go in through those little spots.
Hang with us, guys. We'll be right back. I'm sure you've already heard of the Miller Punch Weight for penetrating the heaviest cover with ease for those big old bass. And have you heard of the Red One Trolling Motor Assist Cable to either add on or replace those chintzy ones that they come with? You have now. And tired of switching in between split ring tools or breaking off fingernails? We'll grab a Red One Wedgie and it'll handle all those bad boys with ease. Visit RedOneSystems.com. Hey Sportsman, have you ever wanted an all-in-one cleaning tool for small game or fish? Well, look no further. The Sportsman Field Tool offers an all-in-one stainless steel construction with all the bells and whistles. From a fillet knife, snip, snub knife, gut rake, and a scaler in its indestructible case, you really can't go wrong. Check your local retailers or visit sportsmanfieldtool.com. Attention Northern California anglers, have you been to Boat Country in Escalon? With one of the largest selections of welded aluminum fishing boats from Weldcraft, Lowe, and Hughescraft, chances are they've got the right fishing boat for you. And did I mention they have a full service center to take care of all your boating repair and maintenance needs? If you're a boat owner or just looking to become one, you owe it to yourself to check these guys out. Visit BoatCountryUSA.com or stop on by. I'll see you there. Ever try pulling a planer board next to your boat when trolling or fishing from a swift current bank? If not, you're missing out on one of the most phenomenal fish catching machines on the market today. With Yellowbird planer boards pulling your lines perpendicular to your boat, you can't help but catch more fish. Find out more by visiting www.yellowbirdproducts.com. Did you know that B-Line makes specialized lines for all your fishing needs? From the super strong abrasive resistant CXX or the low stretch super stealthy CX Premium, or maybe you're looking for invisibility or super bite detection with P-Line's 100% fluorocarbon. No matter what your needs, P-Line's got it covered. To find out more, visit P-Line.com.
P-Line, baby.
All right, Dad hooked up throwing the inline spinner.
What it is, that's a good salmon. Let's get him up here. All right.
Yeah.
All right, number two.
Nice.
This fish has still got all its scales. Very clean thing. Look at that. Just shines like a piece of chrome.
Now another thing, when I talked about the fish positioning, a lot of people don't really understand timing your runs. Well, let's say the fish are always coming upstream, right? And let's say you have five or six runs that you know of, and the conditions are right, it's the outgoing tide, you know you want to go fish it on the outgoing tide. Should you start in the middle of your runs and work down? No. I mean, if you see people catching fish on your runs, chances are there's a school there. Stop there, run adrift. If you're catching them, of course, keep running. But the thing you want to do is run all the way upriver, and you want to work those back until you cut off the fish. What that's going to do is help you effectively pick apart that run and figure out where those fish are positioned. Because in theory, if the fish are moving up and you're moving up, you can keep hitting pockets where there's not fish. But moving upriver and fishing downriver, you're going to head those fish off at some point throughout the day. The salmon fishing year has been tough for us in 2014, but you could still get them.
There's some good days. It's been rough for me lately, but you can get them by doing that. You just want to make sure that you're able to hit all those runs at that key time. And the key time, if you're drifting with the trolling motor, is that outgoing tide when that sun's up. Overcast is going to get those fish moving. You might want to incorporate some spinner casting. We're going to go over that too.
Net. Kenny, pick up that net, please.
Yep.
That net. Oh, right over there.
Ooh.
Here we go.
Set.
Come up here. I want her nose to be in the center of the net. You gotta go face first, all right? Face first, Kenny. It's all right. There we go. Pull straight back. There you go, right there, keep her trapped outside the boat.
Oh,
right there, keep her trapped. See that, how the net closes off on her?
Got it.
Had her right barely on the lower. Yeah, more row, woohoo.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, I need steelhead bait bad. Having to work for it. There we go, guys, first fish of the morning. Out here breaking down some techniques for you. We got Kenny Acosta, right?
Acosta.
Same name as one of my cousins, but I swear he is not a cousin. Kenny actually won the like contest on our Facebook. At the 4,000 like mark, I did a random name and letter draw, and I dropped down, and he was right there. And believe it or not, he's from Stockton, right?
Yep.
Right where I'm living now and running the show out of. So hopefully we can put Kenny on some fish today, break down some awesome techniques for you guys. We'll knock this female out and bring her in. More row for the box.
Another thing, I often get asked the question, I don't have a trolling motor, can I still do this? Well, if you're in tributaries where it's narrow and it's not a main river channel, it is difficult and you can end up running into the bank if you're fighting a fish and you don't have a buddy to control the boat. That can be difficult. And a lot of the time when you're going down, you're gonna see guys on anchor jigging. Well, when is an effective time to anchor and jig from a boat? That time is low light hours or incoming tide. That outgoing tide, the fish often position to the bottom and hold there. That's when drifting through those runs is way more effective. So if you're gonna sit on anchor and jig, the incoming tide and low light hours are the deal for you. And remember, at those times, you also don't have to hit the bottoms with your jig, so you can get goofy. You'll see guys with two hands doing it, and you can get a whole boatload of guys on anchor having a good time and jigging. More than likely, that's how you're gonna catch more. It's not the most effective way, but yes, you still can do it.
Dave's hooked up. Oh, now she sees, coming up like a chunk of timber. Come on. There we go, baby. Some of these fish that come way upstream are pretty, you know, lethargic when you hook them. Just the other day, I had the same sort of thing. I hooked it and I thought I had timber. You lift up, and if you can net them just before they get their second wind or see the surface before they go crazy, you got a good chance at landing them. Let me knock her out.
Oop. So in the first episode with salmon jigging, I covered the colors. So if you don't know the color, scale, and figuring out what I mean by the colors, I'm gonna elaborate a little bit more on that, not elaborate yet. But right now, I really wanna talk about the hooks a little bit more. If you can see right here, here's a little thin wire right here, a little thin diameter hook, and you can see this big beefy guy right here. This is like a 1x diameter hook, and this is a 2x. Now, a lot of the time in salmon jigging, it's about using a jig that you can comfortably jig with and hold a 90 degree line angle. This is a 2 ounce, and this is a 3 ounce laser minnow. Now, the 2 ounce here comes with that 1x. Now, a lot of the time, if you're out jigging king salmon, I will suggest upgrading to a 2X. That's that thicker, stronger diameter hook to where you don't pull out. Basically, to bend a 1X hook takes about maxed out 12 pounds of drag pressure to bend out those hooks. So if you're fishing on a bait casting reel and you have about roughly 15 pounds of drag and you start hoisting on them with your drag peeled down, you can pull those hooks free and bend those hooks out. With the 2X, it takes roughly about 15 to 17 pounds of drag pressure to bend one of those guys out. Your standard bait casting reel has roughly 12 to 15. I fish the Revo SX, which has roughly about 23 pounds on strike pressure. So I can actually fish a 4X hook, which is even thicker than this guy. Basically, what you want to keep in mind is your line choice to go along with the weight of the jigs and how strong that hook actually is. 15 pound, and I'm using P-Line CXX. It's a copolymer line, tough as nails line. I'll use the 15 pound when I'm fishing a 2X. The line has a fair amount of stretch in it. We're fishing 15 to 25 foot deep most of the time. So that's gonna give me a good cushion. That's with that 15 pound and that thinner line diameter in the current, it's gonna help me with a better line angle. If I'm using a 3 ounce, I like to go up to that 20 pound CXX. Really strong, tough line. Can also help drive the hooks a little bit less stretch because you have to pull harder to stretch that 20 pound line. To where if I'm fishing that thicker diameter hook, I want that heavier line to help drive it in there and I'm not setting the hook on a rubber band. If you have a thinner hook, this can penetrate the fish a whole lot easier, but you can bend it out. A lot of the time guys are going down the river and they're getting lackadaisical and the rod's not pinned under their arm and the fish hits them and they lose it. Well, the hooks didn't drive in. Well, a lot of the time that's because they're fishing that heavier hook and they're holding the rod something like this, out and away from their body, okay? They're holding the rod out and away from their body. The fish hit it, they didn't have any leverage. So I often tell people, pin it. Pin it up under your arm. Now when the fish hits it, he's hitting something heavy and solid and you can help drive the hook in that way. Another thing that I also did too is take a little piece of pipe insulation right here, run it over the butt of my rod, jam that under my arm. It's really comfortable when I'm jigging all day long because it can be a tedious, slow grind. Now let's get into some colors.
Hang with us, guys. We'll be right back.
Been thinking about trying out kayak fishing or already into it and just want some sick upgrades for your rig? It's time to check out the Headwaters Kayak Shop. Come pick the brains of their knowledgeable staff and make sure to ask about their awesome demo program to find the right kayak for you. Or stop in and rent one with Lodi Lake right down the street. The Headwaters Kayak Shop fits all your yakking needs. Tell them if sent ya.
Have you been to RustyLures.com? Did you know they offer free shipping on anything over $29.99? And with all the latest and greatest in bass fishing gear from punching tackle, umbrella rigs, swim baits, and you name it, there's really no reason for you not to be getting the best deal online today. So go to www.rustylures.com. Did you ever wish for an RC boat when you were a kid? And do you have a passion for fishing? Well, guess what? It's time to do them both at the same time. With RCFishingWorld.com's RC Fishing Pole, it's time to be a kid again. So visit www.rcfishingworld.com today.
So a lot of the time, also when I'm out salmon jigging, is most salmon jigs come with a little bit of flash in them. These are just standard jigs. They don't have to be a salmon jig. You got a variety, you know, all sorts of different colors, white and what have you. And basically, this is about getting the salmon's attention. A lot of people have an issue of hooking the salmon outside the mouth or they snag it. There's two things to snagging. All this looks relatively the same. Where do they focus on a biting point? Well, a lot of the time you'll see black dots on baits to imitate a black dot from a shad, and they'll put it up near the head of the bait where the fish can get a good bite on it. It's a focal point to get their attention. What I like to do is when I'm jigging, I do a little stutter step. And what that does, instead of lifting the jig straight up and down off the bottom, it kicks it out to the side. If a salmon bites it straight on right here, it's hard for him to get it directly in the mouth. But when you do that stutter step, it sends your jig out like that. Now when they get it, it's very easy to get them into the mouth. And I'll go over that and I'll show you with the rod, that little stutter lift. And it just walks that jig out to the side. It doesn't really hang itself up often like you would think over the top of the line. And your hookup ratio when they hit it's extremely high. Now with the black and red Sharpie, I'm gonna show you something here. Let me just open one of these guys up. First off, I'm gonna show you the side of that jig. Get a good look at that. Got a good look at her there? I'm gonna show you, I'm gonna put black right down the middle of this thing. Now, in dirty water or stained water, they can see that solid black dot. That really gets their attention. So if I did the whole upper body in black, it's a guarantee that they're gonna see it and get a good clear look at it when they drop down there. One of my buddies just actually did a video on red hooks, but I'm gonna tell you another something. What is red all about in baits? A lot of people think the red hook is strictly about, oh, it's a bleeding bait. No, it's not. It's a focal point. When they get close, you can only really see red in the water column from roughly 10 feet away. Red represents gill plates. It represents an open wound on the fish. It represents opportunity. So now you can take red and put it on the lower part of the body. And another thing red really means is when I say gill plate, that usually means the fish has his back turned and it gives him a focal point to strike. Where would you rather have the salmon striking? Up here where there is no hook or closer to the hooks? You'll often see sometimes I'll actually do my hooks. I'll do my hooks up with red. These are all sharpied up and beat up, but they're all painted red. A lot of the time I'll do the hook in pure red to encourage them to strike the hook. So the Sharpies can be your friend. The cleaner, clearer the water, I will sometimes use a purple Sharpie. I was using the black and purple laser minnows. I broke them off my last two on the bottom, but hey, you win some and you lose some, but the black and purple laser minnow was killing them for me the last couple trips out. But that's two advantages to a black focal point, to a red opportunity, and a striking point when they get close there for you. So that should help you out.
Under the boat. Oh, he's a good one.
Go ahead and work your way through, Kenny. Just let them know where you're at all times.
Yep.
Follow that fish.
On your right side.
Squeeze right through.
Oh, nice little jack. Oh, back down.
Sorry, he's right there. I'll lead him over the center.
Head first, Kenny. Head first.
Yep. Not ready to give up this one. Trying to bring him over to you.
Nope.
Get him in there.
There we go.
Now, a lot of the time, you're going to see a bunch of suspended fish. You're going to see fish rolling out there on the surface. And the jig bite is just not happening. You jigged half a day, but you've seen fish rolling. You've seen them suspended. Or you're fishing just the incoming tide, or it's low light hours. Well, all those times happen to excel when spinner fishing. Just a little inline spinner, chartreuse, orange, bright colors, stout treble hook. We're tied directly on a braid right here. Really doesn't matter too much with the salmon. They come up and crush it. You know, any rod could pretty much handle a spinner. The only thing is you're not going to hoist down on your drag with these. It's got a little bit lighter hook, so take your time getting them in. A lot of the time when you see a rolling salmon or a breaching salmon, that is a perfect time to actually throw the spinner to them. The salmon are extremely aggressive when they're rolling up there, when they're breaching. So if you get this spinner in there, a lot of the time you'll get that fish to come strike. Literally, with my eyes, I've seen 1 out of 5 conversions. Not joking, that's a heck of a lot to not keep an inline spinner tight on your boat at all times when you're out there salmon jigging. So this guy, as you can see, with my father right there, Q, the cameraman for IF, he landed 2 fish on these guys that we wouldn't have had if we did not have an inboard on board, and that's strictly from seeing salmon roll. A lot of the time, they're gonna roll, that when they're rolling, they're traveling. So one of those things is if you see them break and you cast to them a couple times, you don't see a follower, you don't hook up, what you wanna do is run to your hole in front of that. Just go upriver to that and work that hole right there. That means those fish are on their way. If you see one roll, you generally have, you know, 15 to 20 fish down below them that might also be willing to go. So run up to that next run, get ready to jig, get ready to throw spinners, and you can cut them off. Now you probably see me pick up this funny looking jig and you're probably wondering what the heck. I actually took the split ring and the hook off the bottom here. I used a 100-pound wire coated cable and I crimped it back onto my hook, and I used rubber bands to hold it to the center of the body here. What this helps is when you're hitting the bottom in areas with a ton of snags, you can still fish those areas that a lot of people avoid with this rigging. Your hookup ratio is a little bit lower, but when they do bite on, That hook will work free. You can pull that rubber band and you can see that's actually how I rigged it right there, turned upside down, and I just put it against the side of the body and rubber band it like that. You can drop it faster. A lot of the time when the hook hits the timber, it's not going to turn over. When it hits on the bottom, if you're getting extreme line angles, the current's really weird, turning on you, and your line angle's not 90 degrees straight down, this is a huge advantage. Yeah, as you can see, this is not snagging the bottom, and look at that line angle. That's, you know, 45, 50 degrees. You really have to get it down an extreme line angle before you could potentially snag the bottom any direction. So this is a very snag-free presentation that you can do here, and this is definitely something you should have on you at all times. So now I want to talk about boat control and your controlling your drift. That's absolutely vital. A lot of the time I'll see this and you'll have one guy here and one guy here and you're drifting down the same bank and you're working basically in the same line. These fish are going to hold right along these seams. I honestly like to fish, you know, I look at the graph, look at the base of the riprap, I'll come 5 foot out, look right there, and I'll jig right along that seam. I like to jig usually within about 15 to 25 foot of the bank. I still really like that, you know, 12 to like 23 foot water column. I like that a lot. I tend to find the fish there. Shallower than 12, I honestly think the boat pressure spooks them. So now if you look at all the debris right here, floating past, you can see I'm holding in one spot. I want to be drifting at the same speed as that debris right there. What that's going to prevent, if you see me put my line in the water right now, I'm not sure if you can see from that angle, but it's kind of pushing back. And what I'll do is I'll intentionally go forward to show you my line angle is sideways. See that? You don't want a sideways line angle. You want a 90 degree line angle. You want that angle, 90 degrees straight down. So you want to be drifting at the same speed of the debris. So if you got your boat pointed straight forward or you're going down current, with the controlling motor, of course you can make it a little bit easier. But if you got your boat perfectly lined up, you know, nose of the boat there, equal with the bank, tail end of the boat, you want somebody jigging on the opposite side of you, or you want to be jigging closer to the boat and you want them to be jigging further out. These fish are holding like this. So what I honestly like to do, I like to position the boat sideways. It's a little bit more difficult to do. Hang on here, I'm going to jerk the trolling motor. And I'm going to come right in here to the bank. And you'll see me getting sideways right here. And just like this, now I'll shut the motor off. I'm drifting right here. I can have a guy in the middle of my boat and I can have a guy on the tail end and we can be going down jigging, covering completely different paths. We're nowhere near one another in this spot. I'm covering this, he's covering that. Kenny just caught a bass back there that just fell back in the water. But as you can see, we're covering completely different seams. We're not close to one another. So now we have a much higher odd at this angle. Going like this, we're pointed straight at the bank, drifting sideways down it, a much better path of covering more water and hopefully finding active fish. Also, when you come back in, the first time you pass it, if you look, let's say I'm 5 feet off the bank right now. The next time I come down, I'll try to position myself about 8 feet off. So I know these lines are covering new paths. I like to run each drift 2 times. If I don't get hit 2 times in that drift, I'm going to run back down to my next spot. There's no reason to beat it up too heavy if it's that outgoing tide and you know that's just the best time to hit them in the face. Now I want to show you that rod tip lift that I do where I'm talking about instead of just straight up and down, I jerk it out and it comes up sideways and then back up. Jumps, turns to where they can get a good chomp on it and then comes back up. It's that little stutter jig. So let's drop it down. Straighten us out here. Okay, so now we're on the bottom. When I jerk, I do this. A little snap and then I follow it through. A little snap and then I follow through. A little snap and I follow through. A little snap and I follow through. That little quick snap is going to turn that jig out like that and give them a much better bite to hookup ratio. That slow, if you slowly jig like this,
A lot of the time, that's the only thing that's really gonna do for you is the salmon, yeah, they will bite it, and occasionally you'll get them in the mouth, but a lot of the time they just slap at it, get out of here. Their aggression makes them force it to get out of there. And like I said, when it's like this and they slap at it, it's very difficult for them to get it into the mouth versus sideways. It's a much higher odd that it's gonna get in their mouth even when they slap at it, because now they bite versus biting like this. They're usually gonna get it somewhere in the side of the head, or they'll slap at it and you'll actually feel a thud thud in your line, and you'll set the hook and you'll get them back here. So that little stutter jig is incredible. All right, so it's been a slow day salmon fishing, but we're getting ready to switch back over to striper fishing. So I like to catch a lot of squawfish, use them as bait for striper fishing and creating chum slicks out there. So we got this one hooked up right here. They're real easy to catch. If you just take a little bit of row, you can manage to catch steelhead right here, fishing in the rivers. Squawfish love the row. And occasionally, if you're further up the river, you can get that bonus salmon too at the same time. But what we're trying to do is catch these guys. Ooh, geez, I was hooked up right there. And use them as cut bait and use them as chum. So let's catch some.
Hooked up on something good that's just broke the surface out there. I'm not sure what that is, but he peeled about 30 feet of line on me. Either it's a huge squawfish, or a striper, or a salmon that ate the row right here next to the dock. Might be the squawfish of the day. Wow, peeling line again, peeling line. He's gonna come up, he's about to breach out there.
Oh yeah, big striper.
About 10,
hard to tell.
Yeah! It looks like we are hooked up into another good striper that's peeling line off me right here. On row, once again, right at the dock, trying to catch bait. Instead, we're whacking good striper. Dang, he's swirling like mad over there. Look, he's trying to find a direction. Look at that. Oh, he's coming back at us, actually. Here we go.
Oh, another nice one. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. About a 5-pounder there. Yeah. Just like that. That's my limit of stripers trying to catch bait for stripers. Go figure, right? That's all I had to say, is that I wanted stripers. I want to show you guys something about this circle hooking. This is a 3-aught circle hook. If you can see, this is why I use circle hooks. Rotated around, got them right in the outside corner of the jaw. These are real clean river fish here, so I'm gonna keep these instead of releasing them. But you can see, if I wanted to release this fish right now, there would be no harm to this guy. I can reach out, pop that circle hook out, and he's good to go. There we go, baby. Slow day, but we still got some nice fish. Yeah.